In this lecture, I will discuss how to answer questions in ethics paper. Obviously, this is a very important issue. Very often what happens is, students obviously prepare for the examination. On many of the topics, they have a lot of information, knowledge in their mind. And they also would have mastered many definitions, doctrines, principles, and so on. So they have the information with them. So they have to answer the questions using this information. But let me say one thing. It is one thing to have information in one's possession or in one's mind, and it is another matter of how to write an answer effectively. So that means the information which you have has to be translated or converted into an effective answer. So today I would like to tell you what is an effective answer, or more particularly I will tell you how you should try to answer the question. What is the techniques you should use, or what are the simple principles you should use? So I am not going to say anything very fancy, but basically I will give you the elementary ideas or basics which will help you in writing an answer which will be acceptable, or which will at least pass muster. And in this way you will make sure that you are making the best possible use of the information which you have. Now, let me also add that, you see, in writing an answer, information also is very important. That means you should also have knowledge. It's not all a question of how to write the answer. The ability to write an effective answer will also depend on the thoroughness with which you study the subject. Let me begin with the pattern of the GS4 question paper in the mains exam. Now, let us look at its structure of the paper. It now seems to have acquired a stable shape. As you know, the time allotted is 3 hours. Marks are 250. And this paper has two parts, A and B. Now, what are the types and number of questions? Part A is about theory questions. There are 8 questions. And if you look at their parts also, normally you will find 13 to 15 parts and 8 questions. This is based on previous examination papers, and there can be some variations. Now, part B is about case studies. So here basically, as you know, there is a case study in 200 or 150 or 250 words. And on that, you will have to write an answer. There are 6 such case studies. Now, what is the length of answers? I try to work out the length of the answers approximately. So the first part, theory, will have approximately, the answers should contain 2000 words. There are 5 questions and you will have to write roughly 300 words for those 5 questions each. And for another 3 questions, you have to write 150 words each. So basically, you will approximately end up with 1500 to 1600 words. Now, in the second part, you will have to write about 1500 words. So, in all, there will be 3500 words you will have to write for 3 hours. So, let me tell you one thing at this stage. These are all rough numbers. These are very approximate numbers. So, there can be variation. So, what is the purpose of looking at this number of questions, types of questions, and the number of words? It will give you an idea of the time factor. So now, if you have to approximately write 3000 to 3000 words, maybe in 3 hours' time. So when you are practicing before the examination at home, you have to make sure that you are able to reach that number of words comfortably within the 3 hours at your disposal. Now let me go to the weaknesses in students' answers. Now these are general weaknesses I have observed. I am of course not a UPSC paper evaluator, but I have had occasion to look at some of the answers which students have given me when I gave them some lectures, or some institutions have asked me to look at the answers which students have written before the examinations in some kind of, you know, trial examinations, you can call. Now, what I found is students do not answer the questions as they are worded. This is one important problem. So what they do, they cover the general area of the question, but not the exact points which the question embodies or the paper setter has in mind. So in other words, when you read a question, you should know that this is the type of answer which is expected of you. So very often what happens, students are not tailoring their answers to the intent or what the examiner has really means by that question. Now they do not go to the heart of the matter, of the question. They may leave out some parts of the questions or sub-questions. Students also exceed word limits set for answers. Of course, here I must say that some students who have appeared in the mains examination have told me that the space which is left in the answer sheet is often enough for writing the word limits specified in the question. But I have no personal experience, but the point is that you have to stick to the word limits given in the question paper. So the answers are also unstructured and unorganized. So they are not look very coherent, not very logically arranged. And ideas are not arranged logically or sequentially. Language is poor with long, loose, flabby and ungrammatical sentences. Now, I will now discuss the first three errors by taking some examples from UPSC question papers. The first three weaknesses I mentioned are basically about the relevance of the answers. So, as I mentioned, student answers are not often very relevant to the question. So, one question is, what is emotional intelligence and how can it be developed in people? How does it help an individual in taking ethical decisions? The word limit is 150 words. Now let us look at this question. The examiner is not asking you to write a general mini essay on emotional intelligence. He or she has three aspects of emotional intelligence in mind. What are these three aspects? A, its definition. B, the ways in which it can be fostered in people. And C, the manner in which it aids in taking ethical decisions. So what you should do, write about these three sub-questions, distributing the 150 words among them suitably. Then you would have answered the question correctly. This is another question from UPSC question paper. Differentiate between the following words. So you have to write the answer in 200 words. So the first thing which you have to differentiate is law and ethics. The second set of terms are ethical management and management of ethics. So you have to differentiate between these two phrases. The third pair is discrimination and preferential treatment. So how do you distinguish between these two? The fourth one is personal ethics and professional ethics. So how do you differentiate personal ethics from professional ethics? So as you can see, each sub-question has two terms and the entire question has eight terms. So what is the examiner asking you? The examiner is not asking you to write about the individual terms individually or separately. If you go on writing about the terms individually, the answer will be wrong, for that is not what you are asked to do. So what you should do, briefly define each term in the pair and show how they differ. Then your answer will be material and to the point. Another example I will give from another question paper of UPSC. So the question is, public servants are likely to confront with the issues of conflict of interest. What do you understand by the term conflict of interest? And how does it manifest in the decision making of public servants? If faced with the conflict of interest situation, how would you resolve it? Explain with the help of examples. So here, first note the introductory sentence. Its purpose is to just tell you, you know, give you an idea of the what the question is all about in one sentence. It gives you the background to the question. The scope of the question, you can see, covers four aspects: definition of conflict of interest, explaining how it arises, how officers should respond to it, and to give illustrative examples. Your answer should cover these four issues and not trail off into irrelevance or unconnected matters. So let me summarize here. Analyze the question and understand its scope. Make the answer relevant to the question and sub-questions. Stay close to the focus and thrust of the question. So this is one important aspect you have to keep in view while answering the questions. The other important point is covering all parts of a question or inadequate coverage. Don't forget to answer any parts of a question. If there are three parts, answer all the questions. You may not miss out the sub-questions which carry tags like A or B or 1 or 2. You know, because then your attention is drawn to it by the examiners. But some questions may not have any sub-questions with identifying marks. So all in such questions also, try to see what are all the bits and try to answer all of them. Thus, in example 3 we saw just now, the question on conflict of interest has 4 parts. Write about all the 4 parts in the answer. If you omit any part, you will lose marks. Distribute the 150 word limit among the parts. The third important aspect which you have to follow is sticking to the prescribed word limits. Now, as regards word limit, interestingly, this is the only material point on which UPSC's instructions advise students on how to write answers. So I am quoting from the 2014 paper. This is what the paper itself says. So this is a quotation. Word limit in questions, wherever specified, should be adhered to. So it is telling you stick to the word limit. Answer questions in not more than the word limit specified for each in the parenthesis. Parenthesis is, of course, a form of bracket. So he says, right answer according to the number of words mentioned in the brackets. Content of the answer is more important than its length. So he is also telling you that the substance of the answer or what are the points you include, the way you arrange your answer, structure, etc., that is more important than the length. You don't have to write a very long answer. Normally, each theory question, as I mentioned, it's in part A of the paper, consisting of two parts A and B, has to be answered in 150 words. If A or B has parts, the words have to be distributed between such parts. What is a proper word limit? So, I mean, when they say write 150 words, it may not be possible to exactly stick to 150 words. It could exceed or fall short of the prescribed word limit by, let us say, 5% to 7%. This is what I call a rough rule of thumb. But in any case, you should not exceed that limit. So now we have covered three important aspects of how to answer questions. Now we go to what exactly happens when students write. So what is the problem with the answers? You know, writing is poorly structured and badly worded. So as I told you, structure. Let me add a few words here. So whenever you write any answer, the answer is in the form of, say like a small short paragraph, right? Let us say 10 sentences, 8 sentences, 7 sentences, and so on. So when you write any such piece of writing, it has two parts or two components, I should say, or even I can say three components are there. So one part is called the structure, the other part is called the content. So this is a standard definition which your books on style always mention. One is structure. Structure means how the ideas are arranged, what is their sequence in which they are placed. And the other is content, is actually how many ideas are included in that passage. So these are the two things, content and structure. And the third point which I have mentioned is language. How do you write? So the language at a minimum has to be grammatically correct in whatever language you write, whether it is English, Hindi, or Tamil, or Assamese. Now, what are these sources, you know? So basically the sources of these errors are bad reading and study practices. This is one thing which happens. So reading superficially, you know, we do not read in depth or in detail. Then when we read very superficially, you know, the ideas are not captured properly by the mind. And they are not stored properly in the mind. So you have very hazy or superficial impressions. So what happens? We fail to grasp and firm up ideas in mind in clear language. On most topics, students have hazy and vague ideas, often irrelevant, trivial, and repetitive. Of course, I'm using some strong words. This is basically, there's no other way of describing it, because these are weaknesses which come because of our improper reading style and our improper writing style. So these ideas float in their mind, that is your mind or my mind, in loose, long, ungrammatical sentences. So this idea is captured by the mind. Of course, but you know, it is very hazy, some vague sentence. It is not even grammatical. You know, that is how the idea stays in one's mind or floats in mind. Then what students tend to do, they reproduce such ideas in raw form just as they occur to them as answers. So all these vague ideas, these incoherent ideas, they are improperly worded ideas, they are all just put in the same shape in the question, in the answer. So they all have to be refined, polished, mistakes have to be taken out. I will come to that, how to practice in this regard. Now, so because of this, what happens? So this is when the answers are written, then what happens to those answers? They write incoherent and jumbled up answers are written. Of course, now so far we have looked at the weaknesses, then the question is how to tackle these problems. The difficulties have to be handled in two stages. First, students should practice constantly before examination for cultivating right techniques of answering questions. So, how to write the answers which are logical, coherent and correctly worded. So, this requires practice and this practice has to be done well before the examinations over a period of months. Secondly, students should answer questions, this I have mentioned as already, as closely as they can, the expectations of the examiner. So first you should get over the habit of gathering vague or hazy ideas from your reading. Firm up any idea you pick up in your minds in clear and concrete words. So the idea should be, so to speak, inscribed in your mind in very clear terms and in very clear language. Unless you do this, you would not have mastered the topic or lesson. Those who are not very strong in their expression can simply memorize some of these ideas. Of course, after understanding them. Of course, here I am not suggesting you should adopt the style of mugging up answers. But what I am saying is, as I will explain just now, at least you should make sure that the essence of the idea stays in your mind in clear, logical terms. Now, let me explain this point a little. Think of a few possible questions. So where I am saying that the ideas should be retained clearly in your mind. Let us say money bill, habeas corpus, feminism, surrogacy, balance of trade, current account deficit, inclusive growth, monetary policy committee, poverty line, good governance, cloud computing, Make in India, Startup India, Accounts. These are, you know, some of the terms, you know, from current topics or from standard textbook discussions. Let us take another set of terms, say from ethics. Some of these could be corporate governance, ethical dilemma, good life, virtue ethics, cognitive dissonance, rationalization, and difference between certain pairs of terms like integrity and honesty, happiness and pleasure, duty and obligation. So I have given you some example of terms or concepts or ideas which are relevant for studies. There is no point in scratching one's head, obviously, in examination hall and trying to find words for such terms or concepts. Suppose there is a concept. This is the concept or term in terms of which discussions take place. And there is something about that concept or term in the examination. At that stage, you know, you cannot try to think about how to verbalize this concept, how shall I put it in words, and how to put it in appropriate language. So, if suppose you try to do it in an examination hall, it only means that your preparation is inadequate. So, all such terms, doctrines, principles, ideas. You should capture much before the examination in ready-made memorized phrases. I am using the word memorized phrases in a sense that you should know how to define that term. If you know how to define a term, it means that you know what are the correct phrases and words to use for that definition. And you have to have these definitions or ready-made expressions and use them in writing answers quickly. So this is actually, it's like a time-saving and labor-saving device. So this work you do not have to do in the examination hall. So I elaborate this idea a little more. If there is a question on a concept, definition, doctrine, or administrative principle, students should be able to answer it based on clearly memorized material. So we have already seen, even in these few examples we have seen, so you know, questions like what is a conflict of interest, what is an ethical dilemma. So at least the first part of what is an ethical dilemma or what is a conflict of interest, that you should be able to write down easily using the correct phrases which you remember from your earlier reading. So you should be able to answer it based on clearly memorized materials. These are topics included in the syllabus and you are supposed to learn them. They should be able to recall such basic terms and theories in standard phrases. This information should be at one's fingertips. So that means you should be completely prepared. You should also keep a store of suitably worded key ideas in your mind. Then you will not struggle for expression in the examination hall. Your thoughts will be in a presentable form. In answering application-based questions also, some of these memorized phrases can be selectively used. But answer to these questions would obviously have to be in your own words, because they are application based, so you would not have read about them from the book. So at this point of time, let me conclude this set of ideas which I have mentioned so far. So never allow ideas to float vaguely in your mind after reading. Firm them up in clear and concrete words. Keep a store of suitably worded basic terms, concepts, definitions, theories, and key ideas in your mind. You can do this even while revising the subject. Now, I will again go to this issue of analyzing questions. This I have already discussed. The purpose of analyzing a question is basically to see very quickly what is the intent of the examiner or the questioner and what would be the appropriate material for answering that question. In the examination hall, analyze questions quickly. This has to be a reflex or automatic process. I mean, you cannot ponder over it because the time is limited. Analysis means it has to look at the following points. This I am putting it very briefly. What exactly is the question asking? So you think about it in your mind very quickly. What are the ideas I know about this question? What is the most logical way of arranging them in a serial order? How can I express them in effective sentences? Now I have taken an example from 2014 paper. What do you understand by probity in public life? What are the difficulties in practicing it in the present times? How can these difficulties be overcome? Analyzing this question simply means looking at what exactly it is asking the student to write about. Here the examiner wants students to 1, define probity, 2, mentioned difficulties officers face in practicing it, and 3 suggest means of handling such difficulties. The second step consists in remembering or gathering one's ideas on the 3 parts of the question. Then let me also give you a little perspective of what actually writing all this means. Think of number of words, sentences, and ideas in an average answer. Of course, I am here giving you a kind of mechanical way of looking at it. The idea is to get a rough idea that in, suppose I have to write 150 words, maybe how many ideas can be there, how many sentences can be there, and how they have to be arranged. So first to look at the sentences and ideas. As answer has 150 words, it may accommodate 15 to 18 words. It depends, you know. So basically what I am saying is that it may have 15 to 18 sentences. It means it will also have 15 to 18 thoughts or ideas. And each part of answer could have 4 to 7 sentences. This procedure is, of course, I told you, artificial and mechanical, but numbering shows the pattern of questions. So answers to questions are actually like brief notes you are writing. So each part will have 4 to 7 sentences. Sentences can be fewer if the answers are written as bullet point. Importantly, each part will have 4 to 7 ideas. Each idea has to be expressed in 8 to 10 words. So all this is to basically make you think about a question, the number of ideas which can go into it, the number of sentences which will go into that, the number of parts into which a question is divided, and out of all these ideas, how many will go into each part and how many sentences will each part consist of. So what is happening here in this analysis is something which you have to do yourself. So this makes you self-conscious about the way you are going to write. Of course, I am not suggesting that you do this in the examination hall. You have to do it as a practice well before the examinations. And you think a little bit about the mechanics of answer writing. Very often what is happening is you are writing something unconsciously, unthinkingly, based on your past practice, especially of examinations, in which you tend to write long answers to descriptive questions. So that thing has to be readjusted here, because these are short questions in which you have to write brief answers for parts. You have to think really of how many ideas are going into each part, how many sentences are going into each part. So this is, as I told you, makes you do a lot of self-analysis about your way of writing the questions, thinking about the questions, structuring the answers to questions. If a question has 3 parts in this example, you have to mentally recollect the 4 or 7 ideas for each part, as I have told you earlier. Arrange them in a sequence and write the answer. Just to make you understand, we saw there will be 12 to 18 ideas or 12 to 18 sentences also. If the question has only 2 parts, then what will happen? Each part will have 6 to 9 ideas and maybe 6 to 9 sentences. Finally, if the question has 1 part only, it has no other parts, then the answer will have to have 15 to 18 sentences with 15 to 18 ideas. So this is, as I again repeat, is you are looking at the general structure of the answer in terms of the number of ideas to be included and the number of sentences to be written for expressing those ideas. The next step is to arrange the ideas in a logical order. So basically, you have already formed a rough estimate in your mind of the number of ideas and perhaps the number of sentences which you are going to use to express those ideas. Now you have to think of the logical order of those ideas. First thing is, make sure that the ideas are separate and distinct and not repetitive. Otherwise, all the four sentences may be about the same idea. Of course, here there is one point I would like to mention. It is quite possible that the part may consist of four or five ideas, out of which one idea may be the main idea and the other three, four may be subordinate ideas or ancillary ideas or supporting ideas. So then also, first you will write about the main idea and then you will write about the other subordinate or supportive ideas. After deciding on the four or seven ideas of a part, then you arrange them sequentially. So you have to put them in the correct order. You don't throw them helter-skelter into the paragraphs or passages. Start with the most important points. I will discuss these ideas a little more later, but let me give a few specimen answer. At least one specimen answer I think I will try to give you. Now, what do you understand by probity in public life? What are the difficulties in practicing it in present times? How can these difficulties be overcome? So 10 marks, 150 words, right? Now I will read out an answer which you will find also in our book, Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude. This is actually a model answer or a specimen answer. And the answers can be written in different ways, obviously. You know, there is no single way of writing the answer, or there is no unique way of writing the answer. But by and large, the answers may contain common ideas, but they may be differently worded, and the sentences may also be arranged differently. And the emphasis which one may give to the ideas may also vary. This is inevitable and it happens. So what I am just going to read out is basically a specimen to explain the things which I have been saying so far, because an example will clear up the ideas in a concrete manner. Probity stands for impeccable standards of morality in public life. It goes beyond financial honesty or non-corrupt behavior. Probity means that public servants will take no undue advantage of any sort from their office. They will avoid any semblance of impropriety. They will show intellectual honesty and give policy advice to ministers objectively. So the first part of the question we have answered in five sentences, and roughly it has five ideas. Now let us go to the next part. Officers face following problems in upholding probity. So here we are arranging the problems in the form of bullets. So we are not writing a long sentence for each one, because we want to compress the answer within the 150 words. Officers face the following problems in upholding probity: lax moral environment, political pressures for wrongdoing, lack of support from seniors, risks to career of honest officers, getting sidelined to insignificant posts, frequent transfers and inconvenience to family. So we have covered the second part of the question, and we have given six problems which are faced by officers in being honest, that is in upholding probity. So the second point we have, we can say, put about 6 points. Of course, some people may add more, some people may write less, it depends. But the main point is we try to stick to the intent of that part of the question. Honest officers have to be prepared to make sacrifices for principles. Virtue is its own reward. They can gently oppose improprieties. They can appeal to the good sentiments of seniors and political leaders. As the difficulties arise from external sources beyond their control, officers cannot overcome them on their own. But judicial pronouncements, CAG audits, and greater risks of exposure may change things. So in this part also, we have used 5 or 6 sentences, and we have kept the word limit to 160 words. So this is an example just to show the manner of answering the question, which is, you know, the answer is basically, it is focused. It exactly tries to answer what is asked in the question. I will give you just one more example. What do you understand by the following terms in the context of public service? 5 terms, 3 marks each, 15 marks and 250 words. So roughly you have to write about 50 words each. Integrity, perseverance, spirit of service, commitment, courage of conviction. As I mentioned earlier, you know, this is an example of a question which you can answer easily, provided you are well prepared. And you are well prepared in the sense in which I have mentioned earlier in the lecture. So I have said there are certain terms, concepts, doctrines and principles and theories about which questions may come. And when such questions come, based on the materials you have already learned and which you remember, you should be able to write the answers easily. So here in this kind of question, the amount or the time you have to spend in doing independent thinking in the examination hall is less. So in a way, these are fairly simple questions, provided you know about those, the terms they are asking. These are, of course, very basic terms. These are foundational values. They are mentioned in the syllabus. Some of them, not all of them. Integrity in public service. So we are defining each term. First denotes honesty and eschewing corruption in all its forms. It also means intellectual honesty or giving correct advice to bosses without pandering to their views or wishes. It involves faithfully following national norms and dutifully implementing government policies, even if one disagrees with them. So here we have completed the definition or the idea we expressed in 3 sentences. Perseverance means steadfast pursuit of one's chosen goals without getting discouraged by setbacks. Essentially, one should not be deterred by temporary reverses. Government's initiatives in economic, social, and infrastructure spheres and for economic reforms face many hurdles. Still, policymakers and executives should not be disheartened, but resolutely pursue such programs. So the perseverance also, we have used 4 sentences and explained the idea. We have explained it especially in the context of civil services. Now we come to spirit of service. Spirit of service refers to the desirable motivation which spurs our work in public organizations. One can think of work as a means of earning a living with attendant prestige and opportunity to make a buck on this side. So this is the wrong conception of work. But work is an opportunity to help needy fellow citizens and contribute to social welfare. So the terms like spirit of service, you know, they may be, of course, here if you want, we can add one more thing saying that, you know, spirit of service also means that the civil servants will be diligent and regard their work, not, I have mentioned it already, but you can add one more sentence. They will regard it as an opportunity to serve people and help the needy citizens. So in this kind of thing, you know, what happens is some of the terms may be, you may not come across them specifically in your preparation. So you will have to use your common sense or common knowledge and figure out some answer. So in these kind of things, what you can do is you will have to definitely think on the spot or as they say, on your feet and come up with an answer. So it requires a little presence of mind. You can also remember, as I mentioned earlier, you have to write only 50 words. That means about 4 or 5 sentences. And you only have to think of 4 or 5 ideas, convert them into sentences, first put them in grammatical sentences. Then the answer will be sufficient or adequate for the purpose. Commitment means that one is intensely and passionately wedded to one's work. Many people work on their jobs mechanically, lackadaisically, and as an unavoidable chore. Commitment is the mark of those like accomplished musicians or scientists or sportsmen for whom work is an end in itself and holds their interest all the time. Courage of conviction means willingness to stick to one's principle even if they are unpopular and face vehement opposition. Often we hide our genuine feelings and views for sake of social conformity or for avoiding unpleasantness. But moral courage demands that we boldly espouse our favorite causes and express our genuine feelings. So basically, this kind of questions you can always answer in 2 ways. One is by remembering from your previous reading, and secondly by doing a little bit of on-the-spot thinking, which is in fact unavoidable in any examination. I do not want to give further examples, because I think these 2 specimen answers I have given should be adequate to explain the points I have made earlier about how to answer questions. So now let me explain, or let me draw your attention rather to another issue. You see, in one of the recent papers, I noticed one slight difference. Many theory questions there contain a quotation which is followed by a direction word or sentence for the students. So you have to pay special attention to these direction words or sentences which tell you what the central themes of your answer should be. So that means you have to pay attention to those direction words and tailor your answer accordingly. I'll give you a few examples. Corporate social responsibility makes companies profitable and sustainable. Analyze. So what he is saying is that you analyze this sentence. So by analyze means that the answer should explain the logic or rationale of the statement and specify its various aspects. So analyze always means that you break up a thing into its parts and explain its logic and rationale. Strength, peace and security are considered to be the pillars of international relations. Elucidate. So the term elucidate means that whatever is the idea which is embodied in the sentence, you try to expand. So expand the idea so that anyone who reads that whole passage will regard the quotation as the main idea and whatever else is added to it as the elaboration or expansion or further explanation of that sentence. The crisis of ethical values in modern times is traced to a narrow perception of good life. Discuss. So here basically what he is asking you is that he has given you a statement and you will have to discuss that statement. Now by discussion, as you know already, you can discuss its merits and demerits. You can give whether there are any alternative perspectives on it. But by and large, the safe way in the discussion will be to cover all the dimensions of that particular quotation or sentence. And if it is a quotation or a moral principle or a moral standard or some kind of value judgment, you can write both in favor of it and against it. A discussion means that you should cover all its aspects. Increased national wealth did not result in equitable distribution of its benefits. It has created only some enclaves of modernity and prosperity for a small minority at the cost of the majority. Justify. Now here this word justify is very important because he says that the modernity has only had a very narrow impact. It has only benefited a few people in selected locations. He says justify. That means on the basis of Indian experience or whatever other experience you can think of, you have to justify that statement. In other words, you should not argue against that statement because what he expects you is to justify it. Even if you do not mentally agree with it or intellectually you do not subscribe to that area, you have to think of arguments and evidence which will support that statement. Now, there's another question. Without commonly shared and widely entrenched moral values and obligations, neither the law nor democratic government, not even the market economy will function properly. So this is another statement he has given. Now what do you understand by this statement? Explain with illustrations in the contemporary times. So what he is saying is that unless people accept the ideas embodied in laws, democratic government, or public policies and so on, they will not be actually prove effective. So you have to explain that idea and give examples. So here the basic point which I have been trying to highlight is that when certain words are used as direction words after a quotation or a sentence, you have to write the answer in tune with the direction word. Now, earlier on, I told you about how to think of a question keeping in view the word limit or in terms of a number of ideas and in terms of number of sentences. And I also said that you should arrange them in the proper logical sequence. So that way you cover the content and structure of the answer. But there is one more thing also which I mentioned earlier, that how to write sentences which are effective. By an effective sentence, I simply mean it need not be flowery. It should not be, you know, like from a literary textbook or a literary treatise. It has to be simple, straightforward, direct, and short, and it should be grammatically correct. This is very important. If suppose you write a sentence which is not grammatically correct, it will create immediately a wrong impression or a bad impression in the minds of the person reading that answer. This is human nature. You know, he will not say that he is weak in grammar, so let me see at what is the content of his answer. So you should not take such a chance. So you should assume that if there are grammatical errors, it will detract from the value of your answer. So how do you do it? You will have to practice at home well before the examination. So how to practice it? I will just give you a few hints. You can follow it. My idea is in giving these hints is to give you some kind of direction or guidance on how to attempt it on your own without too much dependence on external guidance. So how do you practice writing? So first thing, let me tell you, very often what happens with students, or for that matter with most people, is if suppose they have to write about, let us say, 100 words or 120 words, they do not do any prior thinking about how do I structure it. I told you how you have to structure it by thinking of the number of ideas and the sentences and the logical order. They do not also think of what is the correct language. All the sentences, whatever sentences come into your mind, you simply write them down. So those sentences are not very polished, they are not very concise or precise. They are, you know, as I told you, they are loose, long, flabby, ungrammatical. So how do we get rid of that weakness? So this is how you can practice. So here what I am trying to tell you is that how to revise one's own answer. So when you are writing answers at home, attempting them at home, do not treat the first draft as a rough draft. You tell yourself that I am going to throw it into the waste paper basket. But you use it as a means of producing a better answer. So you can even discard two drafts and prepare the third draft. Then you yourself will see that you are producing a better and better answer. So I'll tell you how to do it. So let us say I told you about ideas and, you know, how to arrange. Think of the first idea. What is the sentence in my mind which expresses the idea? So something has come into your mind. So that is the sentence. So you know what is that sentence. So then you ask about it. Is it clear or vague? If it is vague, try to sharpen it, make it clear. Is it long or short? If it is long, make it short. Now, let me tell you, the simplest way of improving your language is to write short sentences, clear sentences, without using too many ands and buts and if and insofar as and all those terms. You know, just make it short, simple sentences. Then is it grammatical or ungrammatical? This of course presupposes some knowledge of grammar, but very often you can make out whether the sentence looks okay or it looks funny or odd in some way. So you try to correct it. Follow similar sentences for other ideas. So that may, you know, you will write about, let us say you are writing 5 or 6 or let us say 10 sentences. Now you do it with each sentence like this for all the 10 sentences, and then you try to write the best sentences you can write. Then you have your first draft. Now after the first draft, then you go over that draft. Then you ask yourself, how can I improve my answer? How can I improve the arrangement of the ideas? Can I think of a better sequence of putting these ideas together? Can I bring some ideas to the front, some to the back, shuffle them in other ways? You could do that. Then you also polish the language in the way I mentioned it. Then what happens is you will try to work out 2 or 3 drafts. So don't go satisfied with your first answer. Improve it. Keep on improving it. So this you should do as a daily routine. And in this sort of manner, then what happens is it will gradually improve your writing style. Now, let me also say a few other things about writing style also. I mean, I cannot, you will have to read some books on writing style. There are many books which I do not remember them offhand. But as I mentioned earlier, I have also written a book on writing skills. So if you want, you can have a look at it. But there is one book by William Stark or Struck, I think. It is available on websites also. It's an old book written by an American author, Struck or Struck. You know, it's a very good book, which if you are able to download it from the website, you can download it and try to read it. So the basic principles of simple writing style I will mention, which you can use while practicing at home. And while practicing at home, if you follow these principles, they will gradually become part of your writing style. It will become a habit. You will see that this is how I should write. So, of course, first thing is you should also look at some good writers. You know, you take some books like Oliver Twist. You know, these are famous novels. Or even some novels by Agatha Christie. Agatha Christie, many of you may be knowing, she's a writer of detective fiction. So I'm recommending her books because there's nothing improper in them. They are very, very tastefully and wholesomely written books. And her English also is very, very good, very elegant. And she writes very small, simple sentences because her books have sold millions and millions of copies. So you take those books and you can enjoy reading the novel and side by side keeping looking at the structure of the sentences she is writing. And you know, after reading, let us say 4 or 5 pages or 10 pages, whatever it is, and you then go back and look at sentences only from this point of view. How many words are there? How she has arranged the words, you know, how she is writing, let us say, simple sentences, complex sentences, compound sentences, how is she using the verbs, how is she using the adjectives, how is she using the adverbs. All this will automatically improve your writing style. Now, let me mention a few simple rules. You know, you have to always try to use active voice and not passive voice. Passive voice, you know, whenever you write by, you say Rama killed Ravana. Very simple sentence, no? Active voice, Ravana was killed by Rama. That's a passive sentence. So you try to avoid passive voice, use active voice. Then express ideas directly. Don't use indirect or roundabout expressions. There's no point in using such indirect expressions or what they call beating about the bush. You know, that expression is there. Go straight to the expression. Then wherever possible, replace clauses with phrases and phrases with single words. I'll give you a very simple example. Suppose I say she is a woman of great beauty, right? So what is the long expression of great beauty? So I can replace that of great beauty with beautiful. She is a beautiful woman, right? This I am giving a very elementary example because we have no time to go into that in depth, in detail here. But these are very elementary principles. Then the third thing is, learn to express your ideas in short sentences and with simple construction. You know, the sentence construction should be simple and it should not become what is called convoluted. You know, convoluted means very complicated sentence constructions you should avoid. Then avoid using too many adjectives and jargon. You know, there's no point in using adjectives. Adjectives, as you know, are words which qualify other words. So whenever you are writing, try to avoid any words which qualify other words. Just remove them, because then your the sentences will become smaller and the meaning will also become clearer. Then do not if you find any repetitive words, phrases, ideas, you just remove them. If the same idea is occurring more than once in a passage, you have to remove the repetitions. Then restrict the use of words which modify other terms and expressions. So very often, you know, I will give you a simple example. Notwithstanding the above stated circumstances, it can be said. You know, that kind of things, you know, you don't have to write, because that will only complicate the whole thing. You know, because you are trying to qualify the idea. So you have to minimize the use of such terms, minimize and if possible, eliminate. Then you try to write sentences in which basically there is one subject and one verb. Subject and verb. So the subject is what the sentence is about. Verb is you say something about it. Then the sentence will be simple and easy to understand. Then express only one idea in a sentence. You know, sometimes what happens if you put three ideas in a sentence, you know, you will go on using words like and 2 times or but 3 times and some other conjunction. So it's not required. So try to keep one idea to one sentence. Now, all these steps, you know, you have to use during your preparatory stages. You know, you cannot try to refine or polish your language in the examination situation. So in an examination situation, you will be operating under great time pressure in terms of, you know, as I told you, the number of words or sentences you have to write. And also, you will have to devote some time for how to structure answers. And you may also have to think about some of the answers you have to write, as in case studies or in application questions or in questions where they ask you to discuss some other quotation which the paper contains. So for those things, you require some time. And therefore, you cannot spend too much time in polishing the language. So your aim should be to complete the entire paper and answer all the parts. So basically, these are the various ways, you know, in which you can improve your answers. So let us turn to one more issue, which is also of some importance. There is one other issue which we can briefly consider. This is about the patterns of questions which are asked. By patterns of question, you know, we have looked at some patterns earlier, but here I have a different view of the pattern or types of questions. It is difficult to categorize the questions which come in the examination paper. But, you know, we can think of some ways of putting them in different boxes or in different pigeonholes. You know, one type of question can be definition of terms, concepts, doctrines, theories. So here basically, you know, they give you a specific term, which can be either a concept, doctrine, or principle, or theory. They will ask you to write about it. This is one type of question. Of course, this is only one part of the question. Then there will be other parts in which they may ask you to apply it to practical situations, especially in the administrative context. Now, another type of question will be projecting alternative or different views on a topic. So there will be a topic and on which, you know, they will expect you to give 2 or 3 viewpoints and finally say what is your viewpoint. So this we can consider it as a kind of a critical analysis or critical discussion question, or you can also call it an interpretative type of question where we are expected to interpret some ideas. And we have already looked at the other thing, you know, the questions may contain different parts. And there will be a theory portion, then there will be an application bit. And very often you are also asked to give some examples. So when the question asks you to give an example, you should be prepared to write out some one or two examples. If it says example, then you give one example. Even if it says illustrate, you can give one example. But if it says give examples, that means plural, technically you may have to write at least two examples. You know, there are also questions which have a wide compass or very large scope. So the area which is the answer of that question becomes very huge. Then how to tackle such questions? I'll give you one or two examples. One question is, you know, they may ask you, what are the reasons for migration into urban areas and how will you tackle it? So as you know, there are, if you take a textbook, let us say, on Indian economy, there may be a chapter on it, and that chapter may have some 25 or 30 pages. So there is so much of material. So that much of material, you may have to compress it into 150 words. So this is one of the problems you will face in questions which have very wide scope. Another thing is, I think I have mentioned it in that relevant lecture also, how will you tackle corruption in India? So this question also is huge, because you know there are several approaches to tackling corruption. So in that type of question, if where you have to write, let us say, about 150 words, all you can do is you can think of six approaches to corruption, and on these six approaches you may have to write two or three sentences, and then you know compress everything within 15 sentences. As I mentioned, in that context, it may be rules of conduct and ethics, it can be ICT, it can be, let us say, change in government policies, it may be increasing, let us say, transparency, it may be legal changes, it may be institutional changes. So all these heads, you may have to write two or three sentences. And there was another question also which came in the exam. How will you acquire ethical competence needed for public services? So this is also a very general question, and you will have to say what are the ethical competencies and how you will acquire them. So you will have to say basically what are the ethical competencies or skills which civil servants need and how you will acquire them. Now, sometimes they will take a doctrine from ethics and rephrase it in different terminology. So you will have to think about the appropriate moral concept which is embodied in that sentence and then write about it. So very often you may have to rearrange the matter you have learnt earlier and put it in a different context. These such questions can also come. And as I mentioned just now, a few minutes ago, there will also be questions with some quotations and some direction words. So all these are different ways of asking questions, and we cannot really make predictions about what types of questions will come. There is one problem with, in general, with UPSC, examination. Of course, this is a problem which applies to almost all papers. The students in many cases require theoretical knowledge for understanding certain topics which are included in the syllabus. The syllabus does not mention the theoretical portion at all. It mentions only the topic. One good example is Indian economy. Now, many questions of Indian economy presuppose a fairly adequate knowledge of macroeconomic theory. You know, but the syllabus may make no mention of it at all. So basically what it means is the examiner says you that while mastering the topic, you will also master the relevant theory or you will acquire the necessary theoretical knowledge for understanding that topic. So basically, friends, let me just wind up in this. So basically, let me not repeat whatever I have said already, or let me not again, you know, summarize what I have told you. In fact, you can read about it in our book, Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude also. We have given one chapter we have devoted to how to answer questions, and most of the ideas I have told you today are taken from that. But let me conclude with one simple principle. In fact, many of we are not following this actually. You see, what happens is that you have to think there are two aspects to the preparation of this examination. One is you have to learn the subjects included in the syllabus. That is, of course, common sense, you. But secondly, much more important is that you also have to look at the structure of the questions and think a little bit about how you will have also about the questions which are coming and how to tackle them. So in other words, you have to become self-conscious and self-analytical and self-critical about the way you are reading, the way you are writing, the way you the habits of reading and writing you have already acquired, how they require improvement. And unless you subject your reading processes, learning processes and writing processes to some kind of self-thinking, you know, you have to think about it. How is it, how am I doing it? How can I improve it? So unless do you do it, you know, this is called in slightly these theoretical kinds of books, they say that one has to become self-conscious about it. That means you yourself should be thinking about it and trying to find out how you are doing it. It's not for somebody else to tell you. These are some of the things, you know, where it is difficult to explain things. You know, a lot of these ideas which I have told you just now, they come from practice and a lot of reading. And unless you do that reading and systematically, and unless you think logically, unless you also constantly try to write and improve your writing, it will be sort of difficult to hone your skill for the examinations. And if you do that, you know, whatever you require, it will become a kind of lifelong investment. Because those ideas, once you pick up those insights and pick up those techniques, they will stand you in good stead in whatever area you are employed and in whatever type of work you do.